morning, and welcome to everyone both online and here at the sanctuary. Franklin Park Congregational UCC is an open and affirming congregation, and whoever you are and wherever you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. We love having visitors and invite you to sign our visitor's book in the front. If you're on Zoom, you can click the visitor link in the chat room. And if you're in person, as I said, sign the guest book in the entryway. As always, if you're on Zoom, please make sure your devices are muted and in the sanctuary as well. If you don't have your video turned on or we can't see everyone in your household, use the chat room to tell us how many people are attending the service today. And if you're in the sanctuary, please note that your cell phone won't be able to access our Wi-Fi between 10 a.m. and noon because we need the full strength to stream our worship service. We have a couple of announcements this morning. They're also in your bulletin. A reminder that the mid-year meeting is next Sunday, so mark your calendars. It's our mid-year update on the life of our congregation. We'll meet after worship in person and online, and it'll be the same Zoom link as the service. You'll get reports on our finances, the capital campaign, and other news. And next month on the 11th, there will be a Interfaith Council's annual Unity Walk. It begins at 1:30. You'll walk with participants of all ages to visit 9 different houses of worship and spiritual centers in Upper Northwest DC to learn about and experience diverse faith traditions. And one last announcement is Ashley still has postcards, so if anyone wants to join her, waving over there, if anyone wants to join her in writing postcards to encourage people to get out to vote, see her after the service.
Thank you so much, Heidi. And a great good morning to you. We begin this morning's worship by lighting our candles of hope and healing for the world. In today's service, we will sing a congregational hymn immediately after the sermon. Today's message is about sharing the good news in this saving work with examples from the book of Jeremiah and the Gospel of Luke. And David, thank you for the lovely summer bouquet that's dressing our altar this morning. Won't you please join me in the call to worship? Merciful God, as we pour out the wealth you have entrusted to us, as we cease our criticism, so lead us into the faithful living that your promises may unfold in us. To the praise of your holy name. Amen. Please rise as you are able and join us in singing our opening hymn, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, in your chalice, hymnal 16.
Thank you.
I now invite you to join in a time of silent reflection. When we gather for worship, we heed God's call and honor our need for Sabbath and rest. When we enter into silence, we attune our hearts and open our minds to a presence greater than our own. As we begin this short period of meditation, I encourage you to bring your full self to this present moment. Set aside any distractions. Lay down your burdens and take a deep, life-giving breath. God is with us. Let us reflect upon the week that has passed. What are the joys we have celebrated? And what concerns have we endured? Are there things we have done that we ought not to have done? And are there things we have left undone that we ought to have done? As we look forward to the week ahead, what help will we need from God or neighbor? And what can we do to nurture love of God and love of neighbor in the world? Let us close in prayer. Source of life, for the joys we have celebrated, we give you thanks. God of compassion, for the concerns we have endured, please tend our hearts. Spirit of justice, for those things we have misdone, transform us with your love. Companion God, as we look forward to the week ahead, be ever present with us. And great lover of all, as we seek to nurture love of God and neighbor in the world, guide our actions and our prayers. Amen. Jesus said, "Come unto me, all ye who labor and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest." Rest and be assured that through the grace and love of God, you are forgiven. Though we have each done things we ought not to have done and have left undone things we ought to have done, we are assured of forgiveness through the awesome and redemptive power of God's great mercy and love. We are loved by a God who above all is love. And now held in the arms of this God, who is both Father and Mother, we pray together the prayer of Jesus, our brother. Mother, Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Please join us in our song response as printed in your bulletin. I now invite everyone online to unmute and everyone in the sanctuary to rise and share the peace and love of God. Peace be with you.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Good to see you.
Good morning.
Hello, Caroline.
Good morning. Hi.
Hello, Chris. Hello, Reverend Love. Hello, Serena. Hello, Catherine. Hello, Don.
Hello, Liz.
Hello, Dan Sack. Hello, Layla. Hello, Michael.
I'm good.
Good morning, Reverend Love.
Oh, there's Jane Harden. Hello, Jane.
Good morning.
Hello. Hello, Gary. Hello, John. Have I missed anybody? Hello, Rosalie. Hello. Welcome to church. What a great morning.
As we come back together, please remute and join me for our peace prayer. First, place a hand on your heart. Then repeat after me. May peace and health be with me. May peace and health be with our friends and family. May peace and health be with this congregation. May peace and health be with our city and our country. May peace and health be with this entire world. Amen. We will now have the reading of scripture.
Good morning, everyone. Our first reading will be Jeremiah 1, 4 through 10, the King James Version. Then the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee, and before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee, and I had ordained thee a prophet unto the nations. Then said I, ah, Lord God, behold, I cannot speak, for I am a child. But the Lord said unto me, say not, I am a child, for thou shalt go to all that I send thee, and whatsoever I command thee, thou shalt speak. Be not afraid of their faces, for I am with thee to deliver thee, said the Lord, saith the Lord. Then the Lord put forth his hand and touched my mouth. And the Lord said unto me, behold, I have put my words in thy mouth. See, I have this day set thee over the nations and over the kingdoms to root out and to pull down and to destroy and to throw down, to build and to plant. Our second reading is from Luke 13, verses 10 through 17. Now he was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath, and just then there appeared a woman with a spirit that had crippled her for 18 years. She was bent over and quite unable to stand up straight. Then Jesus saw her, called her over, and said, woman, you are set free from your ailment. Then he laid his hands on her. Immediately she stood up straight and began praising God. But the leader of the synagogue, indignant because Jesus had cured on the Sabbath, kept saying to the crowd, there are 6 days on which work ought to be done. Come on those days and be cured, and not on the Sabbath day. But the Lord answered him and said, you hypocrites, does not each of you on the Sabbath untie his ox or his donkey from the manger and lead it to water? And ought not this woman, a daughter of Abraham, who Satan bound for 18 long years, be set from this bondage on the Sabbath day? When he said this, all his opponents were put to shame, and the entire crowd was rejoicing at the wonderful things being done by him.
Amen. Thank you, Caroline, for that beautiful reading of Scripture. And thanks be to God. Allow me, people of God, to speak into your hearing about this saving work. We have two very powerful texts this morning to bring us closer to grasping what it might look like to commit to this saving work. I'm not talking about everybody becoming a minister of the gospel. That's between you and the Lord. I'm not talking about you becoming an annoying Bible thumper in all your social settings. We're looking at Brother Jeremiah and his hesitancy to accept his prenatal calling to proclaim the word of God. When we enter the Old Testament text, we hear Jeremiah's uncertainty about how to profess the word of God. Even some of our most devoted and faithful church folk carry this uncertainty when they want to share the good news. It's written that faith comes by hearing. So somebody speaking it is an essential piece of building up the realm of God, since faith comes by hearing. So you say, I don't know what to say. This is what's going on with Brother Jeremiah in this Old Testament text. He is being called by God as a prophet, and it's okay if you're being called as a witness to the goodness of God in your life. The spirit of uncertainty is an obstacle and an impediment to spreading the word. As we follow the reading from the prophet Jeremiah, we learn that our first step is to hear and receive the word. Only when the word has been received can we have an aware experience of the fruit of it in our lives and in our relationships with other people, with the Holy Spirit. When we've heard and received the good news of God and had an aware experience of the fruit of it in our lives, we can't help but share it. How many of you know that it's just too good to keep to yourself? There are variations on how we think it manifests, but when you've experienced it, it's just too good to keep. It may be as simple as inviting someone whom you care about to visit your church. But when something is good, you just want to share it. We want to talk about it. The Jeremiah chapter from this week's lectionary is filled with the prophet's spiritual growth in the context of empowerment. Jeremiah says God touched his mouth. Jeremiah says God put words in his mouth. Do you know what it feels like to have God put the right words in your mouth when you feel like you don't know what to say? God puts words on our hearts too. Our scriptures back this up, saying that out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Let Jeremiah tell it. God had this purpose in mind for Jeremiah even before he was born. In Jeremiah 29:11, these words we have from the Lord. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord God. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. God touches Jeremiah's mouth with God's own hand, telling him, do not disqualify yourself from speaking on my behalf by saying, I'm just a child, Jeremiah. And then God said to Jeremiah, behold, I have put my words in your mouth and set you over nations and justice movements and corrupt governments to root out and to pull down and to destroy and to throw down and to build and to plant. There is a holy purpose to God giving us words to speak. God touched Jeremiah's mouth and gave him a word for the people. What about you, people of God? Could God give you a word for the people? Bless God's holy name. This brings us to the good news in the gospel according to Luke. You know, the good news is a burden on the heart of any who receive it and experience it, but cannot embrace the empowerment to share it. Like our sister in the gospel that Caroline just read from, the gospel of Luke 13:13, when we enter the text, our sister is bent over with neck and back pain, inflammation in her joints, bone marrow edema. She is suffering with labored breathing and lung compression in this bent over state. We believe that this strain on her body is headed toward an aortic aneurysm. And she has been like this for 18 long, miserable years. We can trust this assessment because Luke is the physician of the disciples. We can believe that Luke would notice her ailments with detailed accuracy. This woman in the text is seeking a divine touch that will allow her to let go of the myriad of ailments and burdens that are riding her back. Just a touch and a word from Jesus. And Jesus comes through saying, "Woman, you are set free from your ailment." Jesus laid his hands on her. And immediately, the text says immediately her spine was straightened, causing her to be sturdy and upright. It wasn't way after a while. The text says it was immediately. She stood up straight and began praising God. I believe that from that moment on, she received the courage it takes to know her own truth, to trust her faith that Jesus would meet her in the place of essential empowerment, that Jesus would give her powerful words that she did not even know she had within her, that Jesus would raise up a bowed down head, straighten out some things for her, that Jesus would make her upright for the sake of the gospel. Just a word and a touch from Jesus, the lifter of our heads. This sister was upright for the sake of the gospel. Jesus straightened some stuff out for her. Jesus will do it for you. That same Jesus will do it for you. Speaking the truth without fear in the presence of naysayers. You better believe there are always going to be naysayers and haters, whatever you want to call them. You see what happened to Jesus when he decided he was an ally to this disempowered woman. To become an ally means that you will invariably suffer some of the same oppression of the targeted group. You may as well accept that up front. You will not make a good ally if you can't accept that you will be targeted in similar ways that the marginalized group is targeted. The constant targeting is intended to bring complicity from any resistant party. That's how the oppression and the silencing works. Wearing them down with agitation, criticism, accusations. Jesus healed this woman, making her upright so she could speak a liberating word with confidence while looking everybody straight in the eye. The leader of the synagogue wasn't trying to hear that. The leader of the synagogue became indignant because Jesus had performed a healing on the Sabbath. It is written that this faith leader repeatedly said to the gathered crowd, "There are 6 days on which work ought to be done. Come on those days and get your healing. But not on the Sabbath day." Yeah, the naysayers and the haters were speaking. In fact, the commandment forbidding work on the Sabbath does not even define work and leaves it open to the interpretation from ancient times until this day. But Jesus has a comeback for the naysayers. Jesus has a retort that goes something like this. Are y'all getting on my case about strengthening this woman and relieving her of pain through the power of God that works within me? Don't you lead your oxen and donkeys to water whenever they are thirsty? On the Sabbath notwithstanding, you do it on the Sabbath for your livestock. The revolutionist Jesus. The revolutionist Jesus knew that he was being attacked for making a decision about his role in the emancipation of this woman. Jesus made a decision about the liberation of this sister who was dragging around, all bent over, in the presence of God's religious people. Yeah, he did. The Mishnah, which teaches the oral traditions of the Torah and how to observe Sabbath, is silent on healing, while specifically listing 39 different kinds of labor that are not to be done. Tasks such as building, hunting, harvesting, baking, writing, and leading from one domain to another, which is what Jesus is saying the criticizers do with their livestock, lead them from one domain to another on the Sabbath. On the regular. Our text closes with Jesus calling the question, and ought not this woman, a daughter of Abraham, who has been bound for 18 long years, shouldn't she be set free from this bondage on the Sabbath day? Isn't this a testament to the goodness of God? When Jesus spoke this truth, without fear in the presence of his opponents, they were ashamed. The entire crowd was rejoicing at all the wonderful things that Jesus was doing, all for the grace of this saving work. This saving work, where you and I are central to the story. This means we will share in the miracle working power of a God who steps outside of norms and traditions of humankind to heal and to empower, to embody the joyous good news. A God who steps outside of the norms and traditions of humankind to set the captives free, to give sight to the spiritually blind, to emancipate the oppressed. A God who will draw, set free, and make whole in this saving work. Hallelujah to Jesus. Thanks be to God. Won't you help me seal the word with give thanks, number 528 in your hymnal. Give thanks to the Holy, give thanks, for he has given Jesus Christ, his Son. Give thanks to the Holy One, give thanks, for he has given Jesus Christ, his Son. God. It is now the time in our service when we share our deep joys and concerns, silently or out loud, with God and with one another, If you're in the sanctuary, please raise your hand and Sam Maruka will bring you the microphone. If you're online, please share any joys and concerns in the chat room to be included in the weekly prayer email. Joys and concerns, please.
A prayer for my mom and her and my youngest aunt as they take care of their oldest sister, moving her from her home of 40 years into assisted living, and prayers of healing also for my cousin that he find his way into treatment for his addiction.
God, in your tender mercies, hear our prayers.
Just a quick comment on the joys of a hybrid service, that our family, in being three different spots, but still joined together in this worship service. We have two there in different spots, and we're in person. It's great to be able to do that.
God, in your mercy. Oh God, our help in ages past can bring us to technology so we can all worship at once everywhere. Thank you for being here today.
I'm just happy to see so many people here. I don't know what the occasion is. I can't believe it. There's no programs.
God, in your grace. Thank you, Alan. God, in your grace. Thank you for all the worshipers in the sanctuary.
I'm very grateful in the last couple of weeks for the practice here of high school reunions occasionally. It's brought my sister from Turkey, who has stopped off here on her way to Oregon and stopped off on her way back now as she goes back to Turkey. But it's been wonderful having her here. And it's also wonderful that it drew down my son from Brooklyn for a short visit. And he's fixing things for me as he always does.
God, in your bountiful grace, hear our prayers. Other joys and concerns? Amen. Let us pray. Loving God, listen to the prayers of your people. Comfort and nourish us in both our joys and our concerns, spoken or unspoken, and hold us tenderly as we face the many different experiences that life and being human can bring. Holy and gracious Spirit, we are grateful for your presence as we move into this new week, a time that will bring forth its own sorrows and joys. Remind us to hold one another in love and prayer, reaching out as we are able, to lend a hand, offer support, or share in celebration. We give thanks for the blessing of this congregation in our lives and pray that we might be a blessing to others in return. In your compassionate name, amen. I now invite you to hold all these joys and concerns in your hearts as we listen to our music for reflection, an American folk song, Down to the River to Pray, with Callie McCarthy, Maggie Micklow, Dorothy Mora, Sarah Spey, Serena Wiltshire, Jack Barnes, and Ben Schumann. Yes, Lord, yes.
Thank you.
Appreciation for the life and work of this beloved community. To support the ongoing work of this church, we ask that you please give in person via email or on our website as you are able. Those in the sanctuary are welcome to place a donation in the offering box at the rear of the church. The donation link is in the chat room if you'd prefer to give online. If you have any questions, please email John Tishy, our assistant treasurer. He's happy to help, and his email address is also in the chat room. I now invite you to take a moment of silence in preparation and appreciation for the gift of this church and its many blessings in our lives. Please rise as you are able for the doxology. Please remain standing as you are able for the closing hymn. We'll remain standing for the commission and song benediction. After the postmove, you're invited to join us for our coffee hour today, where Sybil Tasker and Mark Turner are our guests, our hosts we're the guests, come for a few moments of refreshment and connection, please. Our closing hymn, Touch the Earth Lightly, 693 in your chalice. Burn within us as we scatter into the world until we meet again. Please join in our song benediction.